James and invite him up here to explain to us just how you can run a media and technology business in the town of Toowoomba. Leave the notes behind.
Thanks very much, Steve. Thanks very much, everyone, for inviting me to come and speak today. When Peter asked me to come and talk to your group, I guess the first question was what can I, as a rural journalist, offer value to a group of people involved in small business? And there's a good quote about journalism that I like. A US football coach gave a great quote about journalism. He was talking about, I think a journalist had written something about him or his team that he didn't like, and he said of journalists, everyone learns to read and write by grade 5, and most people go on bigger and better things. So I want to ask people to kind of get stuck on the reading and writing part. So I guess it gives me sort of a bit of pleasure now to be able to say I'm not just a journalist, I'm also, as of 5 years ago, a small business owner myself. About 5 years ago, myself and a colleague, both rural journalists working for a large rural newspaper company, we left the company to set up our own online news business for the Australian beef and cattle industry, offering online news and advertising. So I guess I kind of probably, you know, talking to a room full of people in small business, certainly very familiar with the sort of simultaneous feelings of exhilaration and terror that can go with, you know, starting your own business, you know, leaving a large company to do that. It's a bit like, you know, jumping out of an ocean liner into a dinghy. And as you all know, when you do that, you've just got to paddle like hell to make it work, especially when you're competing against a pretty big competitor. So I certainly also know what it's like to have, you know, good friends whose opinion I respect tell me, you know, I'm an idiot for even thinking about leaving a safe and secure job to start a small business. And, you know, to be reminded that, you know, 3 out of every 4 small businesses don't survive, don't make their fifth year of operation. So I guess it's a bit of a relief to be here today. Our business has now been operating for 5 years, so I guess we're now over the hump, so to speak. And we're probably one of the few rural media businesses that's now actually growing. So I thought today I'd just share, I guess, our business, the story of our small business, how we grew it, I guess why and how we started it. And then hopefully, I guess, you know, John and I think Steve referred us before as a tech nerd, something like that. To be honest, when we started, John and I were just simply newspaper journalists. You know, what we knew about online and online business probably could have been written on the back of a postage stamp with a large crayon. You know, we really knew very little about it at all. So I guess along the way, we've made some mistakes, we've learned some lessons. So I thought I'd probably try to just offer some tips for you guys in terms of how you, you know, things we've learned about using the online space might be of value to you and your own businesses going forward. So Beef Central, that's the name of our website. So just to explain what our business is, Beef Central is a website and we provide news for the Australian beef and cattle industry. John and I, again, both rural journalists, so we put up about 5 or 6 or 7 news stories every day of relevance to the Australian beef. So it could be anything like supply and demand updates, what's happening with cattle markets, you know, how political decisions are impacting at a farm level, just sort of anything that's, you know, information of importance to people in that industry. And we also make it free for people to read that, to access that site, because we want as many people as possible to be able to access our news and sort of get the benefit, I guess, of online news in the industry. So the question we then ask is, if we're giving that news away for free, how do we actually make money? How does the business actually put revenue? And that comes purely from advertising. So we sell advertising to companies that are offering products and services to sell to people throughout the cattle industry. We allow them to sort of advertise on our site around our stories. So in terms of why we did it, we were working for a large rural newspaper company, and you know, as we all know, I mean, online has just absolutely transformed the business landscape. And to me, it probably you know, when online technology came along, it probably made more sense to people living in the bush than probably anywhere else, because for the first time, if you were, say, a cattle producer at Roma, for argument's sake, until that point, if you wanted to get important news and information about your industry, you had to get, you had to rely on a daily radio report or a weekly newspaper report, and that was it. When online came along, suddenly you could get information as quickly, access to important information as quickly as if you were living in Brisbane. So we were both working for a large weekly newspaper. The big sort of print newspapers basically found it really, I guess they saw the web as a threat to their business, so they were a little bit reluctant or resistant to fully embrace the opportunities that it provided. Now, when you're a journalist, I sort of told that quite early, they're probably sort of bag journalists a little bit, but you know, when, from my experience, most people who become journalists, they become journalists because they actually want to help people. They want to, you know, shine light where lights aren't being shone. They want to sort of expose, you know, examples of unfairness and sort of, you know, right wrongs, and they also sort of want to get information to people as quickly as possible. And that was very much, I guess, for us. So, you know, when you're working for a weekly newspaper, you get a really good story, you want to get it out to your readers as quickly as you can, but you've got to wait a week until you can sort of get it in the paper to get it out there. So when online came along, for us, that was just really something that we thought, you know, we really needed to, I guess, take advantage of this to sort of help people in the cattle industry to get news quickly. At the same time, another key point at the time, I guess, there wasn't, the beef industry is a very large industry. It's about $10 billion in value a year. But there was actually no single news service just targeted specifically at the beef industry. There were the big newspapers, like the ones we worked for, that covered all of agriculture, and they covered the beef industry as part of that. But no one was actually doing the beef industry just day in, day out, and so important sort of stories we felt probably were being missed out and weren't being reported. And I guess just on a personal level, both John and I have been in the same company for a long time. We'd sort of probably risen to a certain level in the paper we worked for, and then the only way we could really move on was, you know, people above us sort of moved on. So for us, and that really wasn't, there was no indication that was going to happen. So, you know, so for us, it's sort of a long time to be standing still in the one job. So we really sort of had a bit of a motivation to want to get out and sort of move forward and do something different. So for us, it was really a case of, you know, do we, you sort of stay and get jaded, I guess, or you can try to create, you know, go out and take a bit of a risk and try to create something, you know, of your own, an opportunity to move forward. So that's what we did. We set up Beef Central. We made the decision to leave. And so in terms of how we did it, a business like Beef Central, it needs two things. It needs readers, first of all, and then once you've got readers, then advertisers, obviously. So we knew with readers, making the website free for people to access so that they can hopefully share it with each other if they liked it, and creating original content and important news and information was going to be important. That was the key to sort of attracting readers. We knew, because of, I guess, our long experience in working in rural media, we're pretty confident we could do that. Attracting advertisers, again, that relied on getting large numbers of readers. So before we started the business, we really wanted to be able to secure, I guess, some big advertisers, so we have some cash flow from day one. Obviously pretty important, so we pay some bills right from the start. So we were able to sort of secure a meeting with a big rural bank and a big animal health company, both big potential advertisers. And that was a pretty strange sort of time. We're down in Sydney, having meetings in these big corporate offices with these senior high-level executives in these big companies, and I guess asking them to commit, you know, big sums of money to us to advertise with us. And at that stage, all we really had to sell was an idea. We didn't have a website. We certainly didn't have any readers by that time, and we certainly had no guarantee of success. But you know, and I kind of, I guess, I was thinking at the time that I'm probably going to say something like, "Look, you know, nice idea, but you know, until you actually get some readers, we're not going to commit any money with advertising." But fortunately, and you know, to their great credit, I think they really saw that, they really sort of understood the vision of where it was going. They both committed to spending money with us right from the start to advertise their products. And so, and I guess the reasons they explained it were because it was first dedicated news service for the entire Australian cat industry, so they saw it as a really, I guess, a cost-effective and a targeted way to reach their clients and their customers throughout the cattle industry. And also because it actually provided, I guess, a level of competition in that market that probably hadn't existed before. And I guess, yeah, competition's really good for, you know, gives readers choice, it gives advertisers choice, so for them they really saw some value there. So that gave us, I guess that was the turning point that gave us the confidence to, and the cash flow to know that we actually could start a business and get it up and running. So the next step was to engage a web design company. We found a little company in Brisbane, a small little two-man show, and they've been really happy with what they did for us. We basically paid them to give us a website. I think they gave us so much more than that. They gave us really good advice and tips on how to, you know, how to make the website work, how to run an online business. And I guess in return, I guess we've sort of since introduced them to quite a large number of businesses in the beef industry, so they've probably benefited from that as well. So it's probably just that a really good example, I guess, of that sort of, you know, collaboration for mutual benefit and how they can really work well in the small business sphere. So we launched our website. I should also explain, so Beef Central is a website, but we also offer a free daily news email for anyone who wants it to, which packages all of our stories each day. The news stories are put up into one sort of, I guess, you know, convenient email, so people can just get that and then get on with their day. So we launched our business by sending out our very first news email on May 11, 2011. As you're probably aware, you know, they're pretty strong anti-spam laws these days, so you can't just, you know, send emails out to sort of, you know, just, you know, any number of email addresses. You have to be able to show that the emails that you're sending to as a business, you either have approval to send them to, you either have permission, or you can sort of demonstrate a direct relationship with that person you're sending to. So we launched our business, we had about, I think, sort of several hundred email addresses we had to send that first email out to. And if you've used email marketing companies or software before, when you send an email out, there's this really cool little screen that you can click on to call the world view. So when you send that email out, it shows you a map of the world, and when you press send, you can see where people are opening the email. And so for us, everything, all of the sort of hard work that we've done for 6 months and the risks we've sort of taken, I guess, it all sort of pretty much came down to that moment, that very first email that we sent out. And, you know, that was really critical. We knew that if we sent it out and nothing happened and no one clicked on our emails, we pretty much would have made a huge, you know, it just wasn't going to work. So we pressed send, looked at the world view, sort of hopefully sort of see all this action of people opening his emails, and nothing happened. It was just, the screen was blank. And I remember just thinking, oh geez, we stuffed up here. And then fortunately, just like that, suddenly emails started opening up, and you could see, you know, Sydney, Brisbane, Melbourne, Perth, you know, Tokyo, New York, and you can see where people were actually sharing it as well. And I just probably can't explain just what a relief that was, you know, to sort of just see that happen. It was probably the first time I sort of relaxed in about 6 months, because you actually knew that, you know, finally had a bit of proof that, I guess, the risks we'd taken sort of probably were on the right track, and people were finding some value in it. So we sent that email out to several hundred emails first up. By the end of that day, that email had been opened by, been shared and opened by about 6,000 people. So that was really good, just a really good start to get it up and running. So now, about 5 years later, Beef Central, we've now got about 60,000 regular readers and visitors on the website, mainly in Australia and also internationally. Some of the biggest, well, I guess most of the biggest companies in agriculture now advertise with us. But I mean, for me, probably the thing that is satisfying, I guess, about our business journey is that it started with two people on the payroll, just myself and John, and now we've got 10 people on the payroll, so sort of five full-time and five part-time, and still sort of plenty of growth opportunities left, we believe. And we launched another sort of equivalent website for the sheep industry 12 months ago. We've launched a rural property website, a recruitment one, so there's certainly plenty of scope for future growth there. Actually, how are we going for time? I should just check.
You've got 4 minutes before we'll stop you and ask questions.
No problem. All I wanted to do next was just probably offer a couple of, I guess, quick tips, as I said, just from their own experience, that in terms of that might hopefully be a value. Some of these are pretty obvious, but I mean, you're all sort of in small businesses, or have you all got websites? Is everybody here? I'd assume in a sort of business like this, where everyone's sort of pretty, progressive to sort of be involved in a club like this, that
Tony makes it compulsory.
Well,
yeah, a lot of people just ignore me anyway. Continue, James.
That's right.
I'm just the elephant in the room.
I mean, so I guess, having a web presence is obviously critical these days. I mean, all the consumer research shows that the first thing people do is, when they're looking for a product or service, they go straight on the web. They do a search. My advice would be, if you've already got a website, it's important to keep updating it, to keep it fresh. Certainly pay a business to do it. I mean, I've seen examples of people just starting off and thinking the web's pretty easy. We'll just use one of these little software programs you can use on your own and set up your own site. My advice would absolutely be pay a professional to do it. You'll definitely get a better result. Not just a user-friendly website, but one that also works as far as search engine optimization goes, that sort of thing. In our experience, working with a smaller web design company was great. I mean, there were sort of bigger corporates that do it, but for us, the two guys we work with in Brisbane, they're always there. They're always on. So if our website goes down for whatever reason, doesn't matter if it's a weekend, they'll help you. I think when you're working with a small business, you've got people who are just invested in wanting to do it right. So we found that really, really important.
I'm not paying, James.
That's right. Sure.
I'm not paying.
Should be a disclaimer here. Update your site regularly. That's really important, I think. A lot of people it's a bit of a set and forget thing. Just put the website up and then just leave it. I think it's really important for a couple of reasons. Put things up it could be photos about recent jobs you've done, recent jobs you've completed, but video is always good. Just little stories about what's happening in your business, maybe profiles on staff, special offers, customer testimonials, but just feeding information on your website regularly. It tells visitors that that you're there, you're acting, things are actually happening. It also, again, helps with search engine optimization. The more stuff you're putting on there, the more that your website will, the better it'll do in search engine hits. Social media, of course, is really important. It's just a great way to add horsepower to your site, to the traffic. We find ourselves with our stories, we'll get sort of a certain amount of hits on our stories on Beef Central, but occasionally we'll put one onto our Facebook page, and it is just incredible. If you get it right, if it's a story that people want to share, it's just amazing. The amount of traffic to that story will just increase exponentially. The great thing about social media, of course, is it's free. It doesn't cost anything, so you might as well have a social media account. I think with social media, also important not to spread yourself too thinly. Don't try to have 1,000 accounts or be working right across a range of platforms. Do one or two really well. Like Facebook's obviously pretty good. And also, you can use Facebook these days, and again Google, of course, for pretty targeted and pretty cost-effective advertising as well. It's definitely worth checking out if you're a small business, because you can really target down to your particular geographic area of interest, and for not a particularly big outlay, really. So definitely worth doing that. Probably another big one I'd say is also it's worth paying to make your site mobile friendly. Ours is we were surprised, so we didn't do that at the start when we set up Beef Central, and then we were amazed. We looked at our sort of Google Analytics pretty early on and saw that I think even at that early stage about 20% of people coming to our site were coming via a smartphone, and when you tried to read our site on a smartphone it was just really difficult. So we then sort of had to spend more money to make it mobile friendly, but it was absolutely worth it. You sort of wanted to, so if someone visits your site, it'll just scale down, because there's so much. I mean, that level of traffic is only increasing in terms of people coming to your site via mobile devices. One of the mistakes, almost finishing up, Steve, not much more to go. One of the big mistakes we made early on was that the original company, when we set up our website, the actual building of the content management system that we used to update was outsourced to a company which used its own proprietary software. So that meant that when we wanted to make changes to our site, it actually was quite expensive. They really had us over a barrel because we had to use that company to make any changes. So we've since then sort of converted our site over to an open source a WordPress platform, and that now means that it's actually much easier to make those changes that we need to make. And just one other one. If you're sending emails out to clients, and that's a really good thing to do, obviously, to sort of try to develop that database, anti-spam laws are obviously important, and just it's funny how little things that can just trigger an anti-spam filter. We sent one of our earlier emails we sent out had the word sex in the headline. Now, and that sort of might sound like we're sort of writing about things we shouldn't be writing about, but if you think about it in the cattle industry, I think the headline was about mixed sex wieners. But of course, that particular email just didn't it attracted a lot of bounces, and it took us a little while to work it out, and we identified we had the word sex in the headline. So then that was the reason why we kept getting blocked. So. So again, it's just another thing to think about. You know, when you're sending out emails, just to be aware that because you can actually send out, do a whole email campaign, and then if it actually triggers an anti-spam filter, you're in trouble. So just lastly, I'll just say the main thing with the website is probably most importantly, actually, I think is just keep it simple. Less is more. Less is more. Clutter is bad. And you really want to be able to communicate very quickly what your business does, what your unique selling proposition is, and that's really it, guys. So thanks very much.
Questions?
Have you said in the future, do you ever think that with the way technology is going, that we'll probably get to where there may be only one paper a week by going generation, say in the next 30 or 40 years, like probably nearly 100% of people have got a phone now. But do you think it may get to that stage where there'll be less papers sort of dependent?
It's a really good question. Well, look, I personally think newspapers do have a future in it, and do actually have quite a strong future. I think they will stay for a fair while. I think probably a place like Toowoomba, I can actually see the Chronicle staying for a fair while, and the reason I say that is in a geographic area, it's a nice confined geographic area like Toowoomba. It's not that ridiculously expensive to print and distribute a newspaper within that area, and there's still the advertising. There's enough advertising there's still a good business model. I think for the probably more national papers or statewide papers trying to distribute across a large geographic area, that business model is definitely being eroded. Because at the end of the day, for the decision makers in those businesses and newspapers, they say, well, okay, we've got to distribute this newspaper. We've got to print it, which costs a lot of money. We've got to distribute it across this area. We know we could distribute the same information virtually with a very low cost online. So what will decide that is if readership of those newspapers sinks below a certain level where it's no longer economically viable. And I guess that'll be determined by your specific market you're operating in.
Because you see people, I had some people out the other day, and she was saying like she was reading a good story about something, and they're reading it on the little tablet, hooked them up and got the book reading the story.
It's definitely the way media is going, because it's just so convenient. You've got a website, and the biggest limitation is really just internet speeds. Wherever you've got good internet speeds, there's certainly plenty of people that still like reading newspapers, and I do too. I love reading it, sitting down on a Saturday morning and reading the paper. Now the kids are growing up to a level I can actually do that again. I do think there is a future for newspapers. I certainly don't think that they'll be writing the obits just yet.
Can you tell us the demographics of the actual readers? Like, are we talking husband and wife, farming families, or are they corporate, or is it employees of
the... Yeah, and this is with our own site, Gary. We certainly do have that data. We use Google Analytics to provide all of our metrics, and it's amazing just how much information you can get. Actually, it's one of the things I do like about working online now is that you really can now sort of see who's opening, when they're opening, what time they're opening, what stories they're finding value, which stories they're not. I mean, in the old days, when I was working for a weekly newspaper, you'd send a weekly paper out. About a month later, you'd get the distribution figures back from a news agent who'd tell you that, you know, you've got sold this many copies, and you have to sort of try to compare it to the week before and try to work out why did this one sell. It was really almost like reading the tea leaves, trying to sort of work out why one sold more than the other, or didn't. But now, but so with us, I mean, we probably, I mean, the demographics are quite evenly split between male and female. And that's probably, which might sound a bit surprising, but it's probably not really, because a lot of the cases we've got, you know, I guess the cattle producers out on the property, you know, and it's probably the wife who's on the internet who's probably catching up with the news, and then we find that there's a lot of printing stories out for when they get home, so they'll then read the story when they get home. Some of the other demographics are, I mean, certainly with our side, it's probably more the corporate end, more the decision maker's end, managers, owners, definitely a great percentage there. Were there any other demographics? Sorry.
Well, the reason for my question is I work with a group of financial planners, and one of the planners, he is a succession planner, and he specializes in the rural industry, and of course he's always looking for new opportunities. And when you start talking, I mean, to me this just seemed like I'm going to point him to your website and say, look, have a look at this. It's a potential place he could advertise. I'm thinking he could provide you with some content on succession planning. So not only are you providing content on the beef industry itself, but the family side of it, because there's a lot of issues with, you know, dad gets older and he wants to pass it on to his sons and it doesn't get done properly, and there's a lot of liabilities that could have been avoided had it been done correctly. And the work I've seen this man do, I'm just sitting here thinking, you know, I just wonder, to me this seems an opportunity here for both businesses.
Yeah, look, absolutely, Gary. And succession planning is such a massive issue in the bush. And so, yeah, if anyone's got expertise, we'd certainly be keen to have a chat with them as well.
I'll get the introduction to you.
Okay, so at the moment, how big is this email list that you're sending out to each people for your Beef Central site?
Yeah.
You said 6,000 came to your site. How many is
that? That's right. So we've got about 60,000 regular visitors to the website. And that's, as I said, so that's Google. And Google Analytics does all of our metrics for us. So, and that's, I'm not actually sure. It's funny because the next question, I guess, is how many cattle producers are there in Australia and what percentage is that? But depending on who you talk to, there's anywhere from sort of 50,000 cattle producers to 150,000, depending on, you know, who's counting. So yes, we feel like we've got a pretty good penetration, I guess, right across.
But the number of emails that you're sending out with your daily letter.
Yeah, well, sure. So
what I'm trying to ask is how many is it now, and how many do you need to have a viable? Where's your break-even point? How many people do you need?
Oh, right. Well, as far as break-even goes, it's, I mean, I guess one of the things about being an online business is that it's a pretty low-cost business. You know, most of our costs are really sort of wages, that sort of thing. So once you've got enough advertising revenue to sort of cover those costs, you basically, you're in a profitable situation. In terms of actual email numbers, I think the actual people actually get out daily email, I think it's about 12,000 at the moment. And that's how we're sort of, you know, growing all the time. So we find there's about, as you say, Google Analytics tells us there's 60,000 people on the site, and it's sort of fine talking to other people in the same industry. That's about the same sort of conversion rate. About sort of one in every five visitors sort of chooses to get the email. And I guess I'm not sure really what the reasons are for that, but yeah, that's the way that works.
Well, we've pretty much run out of time. Is there anyone else with any questions? James, thank you for your time. We really appreciate it.